Ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ για τον πρόλογο. Ήθελα να πω ότι δεν έχω ξεχάσει τα ελληνικά μου, αλλά με έχουν ζητήσει να κάνω την ομιλία στα αγγλικά, γιατί υπάρχουν και ξένοι ομιλητές εδώ πέρα που ίσως δεν είναι πάρα πολύ βόλικο. So you can take off your translator. I will give the talk in English. It should be interesting and probably not, hopefully not just for child neurologists. So my name is Giorgia Ramantani. I work in the Epilepsy Center in Freiburg, and my job is actually to take care of these very young children that are operated on in this setting. So this is a very illustrating figure of what is happening in people with epilepsy during the spectrum of life, the age spectrum. And what you see is a red line, which is the number of people having epilepsy through the ages, and a blue line, which is the new cases that arise. So it's new persons with epilepsy. And as you see on the far, on your right of the screen, this is children, so it's early childhood, and on the other side you see older people. So what is happening? These cases are accumulating. Most persons are having their first seizures in the first year of life. And does it make sense to wait for a cure until they're really old? Of course, it's never too late. So this is an opportunity, this is a chance, also for older patients. But maybe the real question is, what about very young children? So if they all have their seizures in the first years of life, and we know that the epilepsy is refractory, so why not operate early? So maybe the earlier, the better. These are the results of a survey of the ELI, which was done in the year 2004, so it's 10 years ago, and these are all cases in pediatric epilepsy centers that were operated on within a year. So it's a total of 400 patients from 20 centers under 18 years that had resective surgery. It's mainly from Europe and North America, and some Australian centers too. And you can see here that this is stratified according to age at epilepsy onset. So this is the age at epilepsy onset of pediatric patients undergoing epilepsy surgery. And as you see on your far right, 46% of these patients had their first seizure in the first year of life. So very, very early. And this is another figure to epilepsy duration. So you see the seizure duration of these patients according to age at surgery. And what you see is that the duration of epilepsy on your far left is becoming longer and longer as these persons with epilepsy with a seizure onset in the first year of life are becoming older. It sort of makes sense, but it's sad because this is 10 years ago. So just to give you some numbers, 60% of these children had an epilepsy onset in the first 2 years of their life, but epilepsy surgery was performed just in 30%, one third of these children, in the first 2 years after onset. So what are our arguments for an early intervention? We have many arguments. I would just like to show you as a first example one of my cases, one of the cases that were referred to me. It's a baby, it's an infant. This is a video from the first week of life. And these are her seizures from the pediatric department, from the neonatal intensive care unit in the small place where she was born and taken care of. And you see that she has this spasms, epileptic spasms, maybe slightly asymmetric, and what you see on her face is that she actually has a hemimegalencephaly, so a hemifacial dysmorphia. This was her EEG, also from this small hospital, and the MRI performed in our institution a couple of weeks later, where you see the huge dysplasia, it's a hemimegalencephaly. So at 3 months, she finally arrived at surgery. She arrived in Freiburg in our center at the age of about 1.5 months. And then we did all the workup, had to set up an appointment with the neurosurgeons and anesthesia. and she was operated on. And her weight at operation was 5 kilo. When she arrived at our center, she had 4 drugs, and she had had 7 plus dexamethasone. She had neonatal seizures and an epilepsy duration of 2.5 months, but these are the 2.5 months, this is her whole life. So still, it's a huge malformation. It was seen very early, and it's great that we could do something about for this child, who is seizure-free for over 2 years now. So now I'm coming to our data from the cooperation of Epilepsy Center in Freiburg with Cork, Heidelberg, and Kiel. These are the 4 centers in Germany we're working with. It is not just 1 year, it's basically 15 years and 370 patients under the age of 18. And this is the age of surgery, the age at which surgery was performed. And in my talk, I'm going to just refer to these very young children, so children between the age of a couple of months and 3 years. What about the time variables? This is very important in epilepsy surgery in general, but especially in children. This is the age at epilepsy onset, and as you see, this figure is not very different from the figure from this survey 10 years ago. So these children had, in a percentage of 34%, their first seizures in the first year of life. And this is the epilepsy duration to surgery, and you see that still some children had to wait very long to be operated on, or we waited probably too long. So the mean epilepsy duration in our cohort of 370 was 4.5 years. This is how long it took for children to get offered and accept also this opportunity to become seizure-free in many cases. So let's get back to young Ivy. Was this too early that she was operated on in the 3rd month of life? Or is it really early enough because she still had 3 months of seizures? So time plays a very big role in this issue. This is not a video. So what about too early and is it early enough, time variables? And our arguments for operating early, for offering a cure, possibly, is the severity of epilepsy syndromes in the first years of life, but also epileptic encephalopathy, which can arise if the children have severe EEG abnormalities. The chance that brain plasticity offers in very young children, and of course the chance of tapering anti-epileptic drugs if they become seizure-free. So our main goals are seizure freedom, resumption of development, and the compensation of deficit arising by operations. There have been many, many series published over the years, so this is not very, very new, but still, if you look at this series, the first children were operated towards the end of the 60s. Many patients have become seizure-free. In the very early series, the percentage was about 50%, so half of candidates became seizure-free in the end. And there are some more recent case series, also our case series from Freiburg, with 70% seizure-free outcomes. And what is very important is what actually changed in 30 years of operations. What changed is that at first, in the first series, we just had these children with a very evident hemimegalencephaly, with a deformity, that we did not need any MRI and any fine cuts to operate on or to find where the epilepsy was coming from. And there's another issue. These little red stars are children that had a perioperative mortality, children that died after these operations, which are very, very extensive for their very young age. And what has changed is that, for example, in our series, there was no mortality. So this is what these developments in neurosurgery and anesthesia have brought, that children are not dying. They are surviving, and they're having also very good outcomes. So back to our Freiburg data. I'm just going to talk about these 48 children that were operated up to the age of 3 years that had a refractory structural epilepsy, so we could find something in our MRI on any child. And 75% had a seizure onset in the first 6 months of life, and 1/3 was operated within the first year of life. This means that still half or over half of children had an epilepsy duration of about a year. This is how long it takes in most cases to have the full workup, to get the family decide that they want to have it done, and to proceed to surgery. All of these children had daily seizures, and not just one seizure, but usually many, many seizures. 21% had a history of infantile spasms in this time period, and 40% had an encephalopathic EEG. These children had been treated not just with two, but up to 9 anticonvulsants. In mean, they had 5 anticonvulsants within several months or years. And 12 of them had had corticosteroids, and 4 had a ketogenic diet. So they had a very severe epilepsy. What about etiology? So the gray, the light gray, is the area where you see all the focal cortical dysplasias and malformations of cortical development. It is basically focal cortical dysplasias, which is in accordance to other series. And then the dark gray, it's some vascular abnormality. It's like a stroke, or for example, a cavernoma, which is very, very rare, of course. And then we have the blue part, which is tumors, glioneuronal tumors, benign tumors, and some tuberous sclerosis patients. So we had the small focal cortical dysplasias and the very big hemimegalencephaly. We had some infarctions, some strokes, perinatal, some tumors, and some tuberous sclerosis cases. What about the resections? These were really huge resections. So we had some lesionectomies, which made 40% of our cohort, but we also had a lot of hemispherotomies, which is about half of the cohort, so very, very small children, very young children, very big operations. And this also explains the mortality from past series. And 14%, something in between, so less than hemispheric, but actually quite extensive. This was 51 resections in 48 children, and this is also quite important. We had 3 reoperations, and in 2 cases, there were some reoperations within 1 year from first surgery. We had no invasive recordings, but we have intraoperative electrocorticography in 10 cases. What about sequelae? This is a very fancy word, so our neurosurgeon doesn't like the word complications, and I have to use this word for complications, but this is what it's all about. So complications arose in 80, so complications did not arise in 86% of these children, so most of them had no complications at all. And this was just a couple of cases where we had some bleeding, where children had to be operated on to stop this bleeding. There were some cases of encephalitis and hydrocephalus. And these complications only arose in very big surgery, so just in hemispherotomies and multilobectomies. And we had no perioperative mortality. What about neurologic deficit? So in the upper part of this figure, you see how these children were performing before surgery and then how they performed after surgery. And the light blue are children without any deficit. The darker blue, children with hemiparesis or some kind of paresis and hemianopia, and then hemianopia and then just paresis. And what you see is that there is a shift of children with no neurologic deficit, which became less after surgery. Of course, these were huge operations, so we did create some neurologic deficit, and the patients or the families did decide that they wanted to have this operation done, even if the children did have some deficit, just to have them get seizure-free. What about seizure freedom? This is our goal in epilepsy surgery. And in a follow-up duration, which is very, very long because the series goes back to 99 or 2000, in mean 4.6 years, we had great, fantastic outcomes at 3 months. So 3/4 of children, this is this big blue area, became completely seizure-free. And if we look at the last available outcome, which for some children is 13 years later after operation, we see that still 65% are still completely seizure-free. And then we have these other areas. We have children that the Engel II class that did profit from surgery but did not become So this part, profit, but not completely seizure-free, and these two. And there were just very few children that did not have any profit from surgery. So in the end, 31 of originally 48 were seizure-free. And out of these, 17, which is about half, had no anti-epileptic drugs anymore, so we could stop medication. And 11 had reduced anti-epileptic drugs. So this is really the core of my talk. It's about the timing of epilepsy surgery. And within this core, for me, the most important part is actually development, so developmental trajectories in these children with epilepsy. So I would like to explain something to you. When we have an epilepsy onset in the first years of life, we often have a severe developmental delay. And what you see here is developmental progress according to age in years. This is a normal child on the blue line. And on the red line, you have the child with epilepsy. And you see that for someone whose epilepsy started in the first years of life, the gap is growing. It's becoming bigger and not smaller. So it's like an opening of the seizures. These are the results of a part of the previous cohort. Out of these 48 children, we could get some cognitive outcomes over a period of time of at least 2 years, where we could see what happened out of them in terms of development. This is just categorized, so we have some children that were completely normal, and this is zero, because every one of these child had a severe epilepsy to begin with. And this is pre-operative, and this is post-operative. And these are just changes depicted here. And what you see is that what is on this line had no changes. And what had no changes were also children that did not become seizure-free. So everyone in this cohort who did not become seizure-free remained severely retarded. And what you see is some losses here. So children that moved, that shifted between categories, and no big improvements. Which is the truth. So this is not something that we can offer. We cannot offer a miracle. So these children will not become completely normal if they have been severely retarded before operation. But they will at least not lose much, and they will become seizure-free, so get more chances for development. This is another series of older children which stretches through childhood. And this is children that had glioneuronal tumors, gangliogliomas, or DNETs. And you see the post-operative cognitive functions and the epilepsy duration in years. And this is the IQ. So this is the normal range. And what you see here is that the children whose epilepsy had a duration of over 4 years, this is a clear cut here, were in this range of retarded. So what we found out in this cohort was that higher pre-surgical cognitive function, higher IQ before surgery, was related to shorter epilepsy duration. The less time, the less years or even months with seizures, the better. And this was also independent of age at epilepsy onset, because of course it makes a big difference if seizures start during the first weeks or months of life, where everything for development is very, very fast. And this also determined post-surgical functioning. This is the same cohort, and what you see is the change between pre-operative and post-operative cognitive functions. So everything that is within this range here remained approximately the same. This is what happened. So we could preserve the cognitive functioning, but there were no big changes, no big positive changes, at least in our period of intervention, period of follow-up. So what about timing again? This is again a different cohort. These are children with epilepsy surgery. For refractory frontal lobe epilepsy, this is 74 children, quite a big cohort. And most had this kind of operation, so not lobectomies, but lesionectomies within the frontal lobe. And this is now mostly about seizure freedom. So what is the role of the timing of surgery regarding seizure freedom? We looked in this cohort for factors predicting seizure freedom. So we found out that when these lesions were not close to eloquent cortex, so we had no fear of complete lesionectomy because of areas next to the motor cortex, for example, these children did better in terms of seizure freedom. And when we looked at the time variables, what came out is that AIDS at onset played no role, but AIDS at surgery and epilepsy duration played a very big role. And in the end, the most important factor was AIDS at surgery. And the question is, of course, why? So these are the results. You see children that are seizure-free, and this is the AIDS at surgery. So everybody who was seizure-free was, at least in mean, younger than everybody who did not become seizure-free. So the question is, why are these children becoming seizure-free when we operate earlier? There are two big reasons. The first reason is that they have brain plasticity, so we can operate on potentially eloquent areas and maybe operate more extensively and take the focal cortical dysplasia out and have better outcomes. And then they also can profit from brain plasticity by means of cognitive development. So time plays a very big role in the end. So what does epilepsy surgery has to offer to children, but most of all for catastrophic epilepsies in the first years of life? And this is the conclusion of the series of very young children that were operated on in our center. It's our data. We can offer good chances, actually very good chances, regarding seizure freedom also in these very young children. And these are not worse than outcomes in older children. They're actually, in some cases, even better. Complications are very rare. So these very young children can be operated on, and there is no mortality. There is some morbidity, but no mortality. So very young age is no contraindication for surgery nowadays. And there is a clear correlation between longer duration of epilepsy and severity of developmental impairment. So the longer the epilepsy lasts, the worse it is for the development, and this is not completely recovering in most cases after surgery. So here we have a very good argument for an early intervention. And maybe there is a big window opening for these children by means of opportunity for development. And this is my last slide. It's about acceptance, because in many cases, we know that it's the right thing to do, but it's very difficult to persuade other colleagues or the parents or even ourselves about these operations, which are very big in very young children. So every child is a little bit skeptical about this very big decision, and also their families and also their caretakers. And this question mark is becoming maybe a little bit smaller in the last years, because we know that these children, this gray, the big gray area, are those that become seizure-free after surgery. So we have very good arguments. And it's easier to persuade these families that this is something that has to be done and has a very good result. So in our series, 2/3 became seizure-free and half had no antiepileptic drugs at long-term follow-up. And with this plea for early intervention, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Two short questions.